Good afternoon to one and all. And yesterday we discussed about what is design, what is the basic design procedure. I also tried to connect with or show the connectivity between this design procedure and pre-incubation steps in the pre-incubation. Then we move on to discuss about what is the syllabus, what are the outcomes, what are the also I mentioned about the Bloom's taxonomy, right? So still there are people to be admitted. Yeah, wait, I'm admitting all of them. Okay, so that's fine now. Right. So then we discuss about mechanical power transmitting systems or mechanical gear drives. Mechanical drives, not gear drives, right? And I actually explained one typical case wherein how can we select mechanical drives for a given application. And then we move on to discuss about the gear drives, and in that we have started design of gears. Okay, and yesterday we discussed about basics of gears. And today we'll continue from that. Okay, so I think yesterday we stopped at a slide which was about force analysis. Okay, so yes, here it is. Okay, so we stopped here yesterday and we'll continue. We'll start from here. Now, if you look at the force analysis of pair of spur gear tooth. You can see this diagram over here. So a pair of gear tooth is in contact, and also we have seen this yesterday while discussing about the law of gearing, and it is in continuation of that only we can discuss further. So yesterday we discussed that there is a common tangent, a common normal to the both the tooth profiles. That is we called a line NN in that diagram yesterday, which is actually pressure line. It is the line along which the force is transmitted from one gear tooth to the meshing gear tooth, or you can say from driving gear to driven gear. Now, yesterday I also mentioned about the common tangent to the pitch circles to the gears. So here we can see this particular horizontal line is a common tangent to the pitch circles of pinion and gear, and the angle made by common normal to the tooth profile, that is also known as pressure line, or we can say line of action. It is making an angle of alpha here. Okay, so I don't know, but yesterday there was not much noise, background noise, but today it's too much. Please take care of that. Okay. So the resultant force or force from pinion will be transmitted to the gear tooth on the to the tooth on the gear by means of a resultant force here, as shown here. Okay. Or I would rephrase it. We can say power is transmitted from the pinion driver to the pinion to the gear driven gear by means of force transmitted by the tooth on the pinion or driving member to the tooth on the driven member. So, and it happens along the line of action as shown here. Now if you resolve this line of this resultant force along the line of action along the tangent and radial directions, and if you draw the free body diagrams for pinion and gears, then we can see the resolution of forces as shown in this figure here. Okay, before we go for actual resolution of forces here, let's consider assumptions made in this force analysis. Okay, so as the point of contact moves, the magnitude of resultant force Fn, that is this Fn, changes, and this effect is neglected in this analysis. It's very important. Only one pair of the teeth takes the entire load. Okay, so there is Hello. Okay. Yeah, Jabin, say, you want to say something?
Hello, sir.
Then why you are raising your hand? So yesterday I mentioned that no, even by mistake also you should not do that.
Sorry, sir.
Anyways. Okay, so I was talking about there is only one pair of gear teeth which is in contact and it takes entire load in this case. That is again assumption, but many times it is the case that two pairs of gear are simultaneously in contact. That is also a possible case. But in this case, we assume that the entire load is taken by only one pair of the gear teeth. Now, next assumption is that in the this analysis is valid only under static conditions. Or by static conditions, we mean that when the gears are running at very low velocities. But in practice, there is a dynamic force in addition to the force due to power transmission. And we will talk about this dynamic force in maybe 3-4 slides after this, or when we start actual derivation for the bean strength of the this per gear tooth when it transmits the power from one gear to another gear. Okay, so with these assumptions, we are actually considering these forces, resolution of forces here. So tangential force is Ft, and there is a radial force Fr. Now, how do we show the directions of these forces? So we again look at the resultant force, which is along the line of action. Okay, so here we are assuming that the pinion is rotating in anti-clockwise direction. Gear is rotating because it is in mesh with this pinion. It rotates in opposite direction, that is clockwise direction, as shown here. And this is the line of action along which we have resultant force. And now, what is happening here is that the force from the pinion gear tooth is transmitted to the tooth on the gear driven gear. Okay, so this particular tooth on pinion pushes the tooth on gear in this direction. So we will show the direction of resultant force as shown here on the tooth of the driven. So we can see here in this free body diagram, we can see this Fn, that is the resultant force, is shown as it is along the line of action along on the at the point of contact or pitch point on the driven gear. Okay, and then there is the equal and opposite reaction which is shown here. Fn is equal and opposite, and that is acting at the pitch point on the pinion or driving gear. Okay, so that is the way we will have the directions for the forces. And now we will resolve this resultant force in tangential and radial direction. Okay, so that is done with the help of pressure angle. Now, if you look at this tangential force Ft and in this triangle, we can write tangential force is equal to, or this tangential force and relation between tangential and resultant force is given as Fn is equal to Ft upon cos alpha, or you can write Ft is equal to Fn cos alpha. Okay, so here we can see this relation. Fn is equal to Ft cos alpha, Ft upon cos alpha, or Ft is equal to Fn into cos alpha. If you look at the radial component Fr, it is sine component here, or we can consider if this is the triangle, then this Fr is vertical side of this triangle. So we can consider Fr is equal to Ft tan alpha, and sine component comes in the form of Fn. Okay, so if you again substitute for Fn, you will get this relation Fr is equal to Ft tan alpha. Now, if you look at this diagram here, the radial direction force Fr is actually a separating force. It tries to separate these two gears, and therefore it applies a compressive load on the gear shaft, the pinion as well as the driven gear. Whereas the tangential force is the useful force because it helps in transmitting power from pinion to the gear. Now, how you are going to find out what is the torque transmitted to the shaft of gear 2? We will consider the force transmitted at the pitch circle diameter, tangential force, into what is the radius. Okay, so we can write a relation here. Ft, that is tangential force, into radius d prime upon 2, where d prime is the diameter of this particular gear. Or initially we'll consider at the start we are going to consider the power received by the driving or pinion from the motor, and that power at the shaft of this driving pinion is calculated by the normal equation, that power is equal to 2 pi nt, okay, which is modified here as t or mt, that is torsional moment, is equal to 16 into 10 to 6 kilowatt is power, divided by 2 pi n, where n is the speed of rotation. Okay, so this, in this way we can find out what is the torque available at the shaft of the driving member, and then this particular torque is transmitted to the gear which is in engagement or which is in mesh by this particular relation. So ft is equal to twice mt by d prime. Okay, so the same force ft is applied at the pitch circle or at pitch point on the pitch circle of the driving pinion also. So ft is equal to twice mt upon d prime. So these are very useful relations, and they are very like starting point for analysis of the spur gears. So before we move on to discussion about how are we going to design the spur gear from on the basis of beam strength, we will try to solve one problem on this. Okay, so now this problem number one, which I have mentioned on this slide, is only related to the force analysis. It's different from that problem which we have started solving yesterday. Okay, here we will just take care of how the forces are analyzed in this, and then we'll move on to our main problem. So let us solve this problem first. So I think there's no need for you to write down this. You can take a screenshot of this if you want, or as I mentioned, I will share the PPT, so it will be available there. But I will read through the statement of problem, and then I will explain how to solve, and we will do it on Octave. So when I'm doing it on Octave, you need to tell me what are the answers before I solve it. Okay, so you should be ready with your calculators and notebook so that you can write down equations what just now we have discussed. All these relations we are going to make use of, and we are going to solve this particular problem. So I'm going to read through the statement of problem here. So the pitch circles of a train of spur gears is shown in this figure here. The gear A receives 3.5 kilowatt of power at 700 rpm through its shaft and rotates in clockwise direction. Okay, so it rotates in clockwise direction. Gear B is the idler gear, while the gear C is the driven gear. The number of teeth on gears A, B, C are 30, 60, and 40, respectively, while the module is 5 millimeters for all these gears. Okay, now what is the problem in this? We need to calculate the torque on each gear shaft, the components of gear tooth forces, that's what we just discussed, all those things we just now discussed. Draw the free body diagram of forces and determine the reaction on the idler gear shaft. Okay, so finally we need to find out what is the reaction at this idler gear shaft. Assume 20 degree involute system for the gears. Okay, so this is the problem statement. Now in order to solve this, we need to first of all draw the free body diagram for this gear train, which is similar to what we just now considered. Now, if you consider this particular gear A, it is rotating in clockwise direction. So, tooth on this gear A will transmit force to the tooth on meshing tooth on this gear B, which is idler gear. So, it will start rotating in anti-clockwise direction like this. Okay. So, I'll just show the free body diagram for this on the next slide. Okay, so in that problem, this is the given data. The power is 3.5 kilowatt. The speed at the pinion is 700 rpm. ZA, ZB, ZC are 30, 60, 40. Module is 5 millimeters and pressure angle is 20 degrees. This is given data. And now if you consider the pinion and the gear, this is the force system or resolution of forces. So as I mentioned, we will consider the forces at the pitch point on the pitch circle of both gears, pinion and idler gear, or gear A and gear B. Okay, so because the pinion is rotating in clockwise direction, it will the tangential force on the idler gear will be shown in the same direction as that of the rotation of the pinion. Okay, so you can see here Ft is shown in the same direction as that of the clockwise rotation, and to this there is equal and opposite reaction by the tooth on the idler gear to tooth on the pinion. So there is Ft in this direction as shown, and there is a separating force Fr acting on radially. So it will try to impose compressive forces on the shafts of gear A and gear B. Similarly, now gear B is in also mesh with gear C, as shown here. Here, now in this case, if you look at only this pair, the gear B becomes driver and gear C is driven. Okay, so in the similar way, we will draw the forces at pitch point. So now the tooth on gear B becomes driving tooth. Therefore, we will show the direction of tangential force on the tooth of gear C, which is driven gear, in the same direction as that of the direction of rotation of gear B. Okay, so therefore it is anti-clockwise and it is shown in this direction here, right? So this, to this tangential force, there is equal and opposite reaction on the tooth of gear B. Well, again there is a separating force Fr acting radially on both the gears. So this is the overall free body diagram for the particular gear train shown on the previous slide. Now we are going to find out what are the torques, what are the these tangential and radial forces, and also what is the reaction at this particular shaft of idler gear. Okay, so for that purpose, I will just make use of this Octave software to show you.
Sir,
tell me.
Sir, can you explain that Ft plus Fr once again?
I didn't explain Ft plus Fr. No. Did I explain?
No, because it.
no, it is shown here, but you are talking about this, right? Ft plus
Yeah,
Fr.
That component.
Yeah, I didn't explain that.
Right. And sir, so, about the direction of Ft.
What is that? Can you repeat it?
Sir, the direction of Ft. On A.
Yeah, go ahead. On.
Yeah, sir. Why is it upwards?
Ek minute. Excuse me. Okay, so let's consider the gear A and B once again. Is that fine?
Okay, sir.
Or which you are talking about, this C Ft?
Sir, any two. A or B or B or C, anything.
Okay, so what I'm saying is that how power is transmitted from driving gear to gear B because of meshing of teeth, right? And we are assuming that only one pair of teeth, gear teeth, is in mesh, or they are in contact at that particular point, right? So now this particular, if you look at this gear A, it rotates in clockwise direction. Okay, so if you assume the tooth on this particular gear here, it will be moving in this direction tangentially. Okay, is that fine?
Yes, sir.
If you draw a tangent on this pitch point, it will be something like this, this line. Okay, and because it is rotating in a clockwise direction, okay, and this particular tooth is in contact with the tooth on this idler gear, so what essentially is happening is that this particular direction, it will actually, as I mentioned, there will be a resultant force along the line of action. Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yes.
Okay, that's fine. So that resultant force, I have just directly what I have done here, considered the resolved forces. So we have just now on the previous slide, we saw how can we resolve the forces in tangential and radial direction, right? So what in that I explained that gear tooth on driving gear will impart the force because of its motion and torque available at the shaft on the gear tooth, which is in mesh with the gear, which is in mesh with the tooth on gear A, in this direction. So it will try to push the tooth on this gear B in clockwise direction like this, but it will happen in tangential direction. So because of that, gear B will or tooth on the gear B will be moving in this direction like this. Is it fine?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So because of this, what is happening is that as if you are pushing somebody, so you are applying force at this point. So this particular tooth is driver, here it is driven. So we are showing this FT direction in this direction downward, but along the tangent. But now they are in mesh, so we are applying the Newton's third law, equal and opposite forces. So because the tooth on gear A is applying force on tooth on gear B, okay, similarly gear B tooth will try to resist that. Therefore there will be reaction on the side of the tooth which is in contact with the tooth on the gear B, as shown here. It is FT is equal in, it will be in upward direction. Any difficulty with this?
No, sir.
Is it clear?
Yes, yes.
Okay. And in this case, FR is clear. It is always directed towards the center of the rotation.
Yes, sir.
Right. So now, in the similar way, if you consider gear B and C, now we'll have to look at the which is driver and which is driven. Okay. So in gear B and C, gear B, even though it is idler, it becomes driver. Okay. And therefore, we will apply the same methodology. We will show the direction of tangential forces FT in this direction upwards, whereas FT in downward direction along the tangent line on gear B, and FR forces or radial forces are shown as shown here. Any difficulty with this?
No, sir.
No. Fine. So let's go ahead. I have not discussed about why it is added here. We'll just discuss about that when we will talk about how to find out reaction at the shaft on the gear B. Okay, so before that, we'll find out what are these forces FR, FT, and what are the torques on the different shafts. Fine. So for that purpose, as I mentioned, I will be making use of, I will be using this software Octave. It's open source software. You can actually download this on your computer. Okay, and this is very simple to use. If you know about MATLAB, it's same, syntax is same. Okay, so today I have just this wrote this program for this particular solution of this problem, but then next time onwards I'll just keep on doing here itself. When we actually, as and when it is required, we will do it here. Okay, so let me go back to the previous slide where we have the equations like here. Now the problem is that we need to find out what are the torques on the shafts. Okay, so what is the torque equation? It is here. MT is equal to 60 into 10 raised to 6 kilowatt upon 2 pi n. I want all of you to write down in this, in your notebook about this. Write down this equation. MT is equal to 16 to 10 raised to 6 kilowatt upon 2 pi n. Okay. And when you write this, what is given data in this? Substitute that. And if you consider the pinion driver is connected to the prime mover, the motor. Therefore, same torque is available at the shaft of the pinion. So therefore, we can just consider what is the speed given in the statement of problem, what is the power given in the statement of problem, and find out what is the value of MT. Just calculate that and let me know. So I'll just see, we can cross verify the answers here.
1.36 into 10 to 6.
So we have used this particular formula, MT. See now, before we actually go for a solution, please see, look at the line number 19 here, all of you. Okay, so MTA, which is written here, M suffix T, and A, we can write into bracket, and suffix to that bracket is capital A. Okay. So that way you should write in your notebook, but it is not possible on this software. So therefore I'm writing it like this, MTA, but it is quite clear. It appears, right? I hope it is equal to 16 to 10 raised to 6 into kilowatt. That is what is mentioned there, divided by 2 into pi. Pi is pi. that is syntax of this particular software, into NA. What is the speed of pinion A?
So yeah. 47.74 kilo Newton per millimeter.
No, no, it will be Newton millimeter, no, not per millimeter.
Yeah, sorry.
Okay. Yeah. So what I'll do, I'll just put a breakpoint here. Okay, it's already there. Okay, and I'll just run this portion of the code wherein I have mentioned all the given data here. Okay. Only important thing is that in this code, we need to convert the pressure angle, which is in degrees, into radians. Okay, so that is very important instruction, or you can say suggestion over here. And then I have calculated DA prime, that is pitch circle diameter of gear A, DB prime and DC prime, by considering module into number of teeth on that particular gear. Okay, so I have just written the statements. Now, if you look at this particular lines 15, 16, 17, I have not put the semicolon in front of these lines. That indicates when I run this code, it will print the answers or values of DA prime to DC prime in the command window. Here it is command window. Right? And because I am putting the breakpoint at the line number 22, it will execute all the lines before this line. Okay, so let me execute and see what is the answer. Let's see whether it is. Well, so it is 47,746.48 or into it's in Newton millimeter. Is it right? This is the right answer. Did you get this answer?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so
yes, sir.
Mm-hmm, great. So
yes, sir.
Fine. Okay, so now we'll move on to next. Okay, next line of the code, that is we want to find out. So MTA is the torque available at the shaft top pinion gear. Now what is the torque available at the idler gear B? Now here I have written a statement saying clearly, see here, commented statements by percentage sign will be like sort of in the problem solution we write the statements, no? Okay, why we are doing the next step, or what is the reason behind that. So in the commented portion, I'll be writing these things here. So gear B is idler and does not transmit torque to its shaft. It just transmits power from gear A to gear C. Therefore, torque at gear B shaft is zero. And the gear this particular gear B on that shaft will be just freely rotating actually. It's not transmitting power. So it is not connected to that shaft actually. Okay, therefore torque transmitted to the shaft of gear B will be zero. Is that fine? Next is that since the power, same power is transmitted from gear A to C, in a gear train, you might have studied in kinematics of machinery, gear trains. And for simple gear train, you can write the relation between torque transmitted and power, torque transmitted and speed for every stage. Every train, right? So if you do that, the parameters related to idler gear will be cancelled out. Therefore, we can write MTA into NA is equal to MTC into NC. So this is the same power is transmitted from gear A to C. And we also know that NA into ZA is like N1 T1 is equal to N2 T2, NC into ZC. When you make the use of these two equations, we end up with this equation, MTC is equal to MTA into ZC upon ZA, right? So if I write down this and if I execute this particular portion of the code, you will be in a position, we will find out what is value of MTB, it is zero, which is already mentioned, and what is value of MTC. Okay, so please calculate that and let me know what is the value of MTC. Anybody? We have already calculated MTA, 47,000 something. We know ZC, we know ZA. So substitute that and let me know. So by the time I'll just run.
35.8K.
Acha, so I put breakpoint at wrong position. I'll run one more time. Well, okay, so now it would have calculated MTC and the tangential forces and radial forces between gear A and B also. Okay, so before we go for that, now we can make use of that tangential force equation. Ft is equal to twice mt by d prime, right? So it is written here, Ft AB, that means tangential force between A and B gears is equal to twice mt A upon d A prime. Okay, so and Fr AB is equal to Ft AB, that's what just now find out here, into tan alpha. Okay, so I have written alpha as it is because it doesn't accept that alpha symbol here. Okay, so now we'll just see what are the values for that. Just cross verify these answers. Okay, so value of MTC is 63.66. Newton millimeter. Tangential force between A and B, 636.62 newton. Are you getting this? Any answers? Cross verify. Also, radial force is equal to Ft tan alpha, which is 231.71. It's in newton. Here I have not mentioned the units, but you should write the units in your notebook. Anybody? So Swati, if you are listening, please remember that you should take the attendance also.
Yes, sir.
Okay, and that is unless and until I tell somebody else, you should do it. Okay, so shall we go ahead? Have you calculated what are the values of Ft and Fr?
Yes, sir, it is coming as 636.62.
Right, FR value, just check out FR value. It is into tan alpha, 20 degrees, tan 20.
Yes, sir, it is coming as 231.71.
Okay, fine. So now you calculate, first of all, because I had to run this code, therefore these values I have shown. Now I will explain about the, before that, we need to find out what are the tangential and radial forces between B and C also, right? Now, because the gear B is just idler, it transmits torque from gear A to C as it is. Therefore, the tangential force between A and B will be equal to tangential force between B and C. And as tangential force between A and B and that of the B and C is equal, we can also write the radial force is also equal. So therefore, we can write we can actually make use of it this thing. No, it cannot be equal. We need to multiply by the radii. We need to take the moment. We'll just take the moment. Okay, so let me go back to the slide here. Okay, so we can write here, if you take the moment about this particular point, you can write Ft into dB, dB prime will be equal to Ft into dB prime. Okay, so using that relation, we can find out. Therefore it is equal. Yes, because dB prime is same on both sides. Okay, here Ft into AB into dB prime is equal to Ft into BC into dB. It should be dB prime actually. Right, you are taking moment about center of gear B, and from here we can prove that Ft AB is equal to Ft BC, and therefore the radial forces will be also same. Right. Now, hello. Somebody is speaking unnecessarily here. Well, now I'll talk about this reaction at the shaft of gear B. As I mentioned, gear B shaft is not transmitting any torque. So gear B is freely rotating about its shaft. But because there is a radial force FR and tangential force FT in this direction, there will be equal and opposite reaction at the shaft. Okay, so to this force FT, there is an equal and opposite reaction at the shaft. To this force FR, there is equal and opposite reaction at the shaft here. And for these forces, obviously, again, for FR, we have FR here. And for FT, we have this FT. So therefore, we can see the reaction at the shaft of the gear B is the resultant due to these forces. Okay, so we can see the total force in upward direction along this line is FT plus FR. So along this line, because this FR is coming downwards, FT is also coming downwards here. So addition of these two will be equal reaction. So FT plus FR. Similarly, we get FT plus FR along this line. Any difficulty with this? I hope there shouldn't be. Okay, now what is that overall or resultant reaction at the shaft of gear? It will be resultant of these two vectors. Okay, so we can just take the Jason is raising hand again and again. I don't know what is happening to him. If you are if you are asking some questions, please go ahead. Okay, so resultant reaction at shaft of idler gear B, which is mentioned on the line number 40, RB is equal to square root of twice into FTAB plus FRAB square of that. All right, any difficulty with this equation? We are writing here like FT plus FR square plus FT plus FR square. Okay, so it is twice. So can you calculate this and let me know what is the value of RB? So do that and let me know.
One double two eight.
Let me run this. Yes, it is 1228 newton. Okay, so that is the way we are going to deal with the problems in this particular on this virtual platform. Is this fine with you? Hello.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's fine. And as I mentioned, though I am using this particular Octave software, actually, essentially, I'm using it as a calculator. I'm not writing codes in this, actually. If you see, I have to just key in what is the given data, and then I'll write the formula, and we'll just run it, and we'll solve the, we'll find out answer for that. So it is like a calculator for me. Well, Zakaria, tell me.
Sir, can you mind explaining the FT part again? Sir, direction.
Directions. Confusion. That's fine. Yeah. I'll do that one second. Can you just tell what is the confusion?
Sir, I can't come to know why the direction is like that.
Acha. Okay. So let me go back to the place where I have shown tooth in contact. Well, here. Right. Once again, we'll look at this particular pair of teeth in contact. Can you see this? Okay.
Yes.
So we are considering this is the portion of pinion. It is rotating anticlockwise in this way, right? And because of that rotation gear and this tooth on gear B or this particular gear is in contact with the tooth on pinion, the gear is rotating in clockwise direction as shown here, right? So now we are interested to see a resolution of forces. So we assume some resultant force acting or imparted by the tooth on the driver to the tooth on the driven here, okay, along the line of action, right? And that line of action meets at the pinch point here. You can see, therefore, I have considered this pinch point on the pinch circle lines or pinch circles here for pinion and the gear. Okay, so when you consider this Fn resultant force acting at this point at an angle of alpha, okay, so I have just drawn this particular Fn here on the gear okay, in the same direction, because this resultant force Fn is imparted to the tooth of gear by the tooth of pinion. Okay, so it's like tooth of gear pinion is pushing the tooth of gear here. It's like pushing here in this way. So therefore, it is shown in the same direction here as at this pitch point. Any difficulty with this?
Okay,
fine. Is that fine? Now what I'm doing is that I'm resolving this forces, this force, resultant force, in tangential and radial direction. Okay, so therefore you can see here, tangential component of this Fn will be horizontal, radial component is vertical. Okay, and because this Fn vector is directed towards downward line at an angle of alpha, Ft direction will be towards right. Because it is a vector, no, force is a vector quantity, right? So direction of force vector is towards right for tangential component, which is horizontal. Whereas the direction of force component Fr is downward, okay, which is radial component, right? So then by simple geometry, we can actually find out what is Ft and what is Fr, or what is their relationship. Is that fine? Right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now this is in relation to the tooth on gear. Okay, so this force is shown, force applied by the tooth on pinion to the tooth on gear. Now, because this pinion tooth is imparting force or imposing force on this gear, tooth of gear, therefore there is equal and opposite reaction to it by Newton's third law. Okay, so that reaction to this line on this along this line of action will be equal and opposite, and that is shown at this pitch point on the pitch circle of pinion. So that's what is shown here. Fn is towards upward direction along the same line, and if you resolve these forces, then you see Ft is equal and opposite to this Ft, whereas Fr is equal and opposite to this Fr. Okay, so this is what is the way. In this way, we show the directions of the resolved forces. Any difficulty in this?
No, sir.
So I hope there is no confusion in this now.
Yes. Right.
Now, just for sake of what to say, remembering every time, you are not going to analyze in this way, right? So what do we say? The tangential force on the driving on the driven gear is in the same direction as that of the driver. Okay, driver is moving anti-clockwise. So therefore, it will be moving in this direction. Yeah. And then there is, we show equal and opposite on the driver. So here it's important to understand that the driving gear tooth will push the tooth of gear B, driven gear, and the driven gear tooth will give equal and opposite reaction to that force. Okay, that's the way it is actually. I hope it is clear. Still, if any difficulty, you can mail me and we can have a discussion through mails also, or you can call me also. There is no difficulty.
Yes, sir. Understood.
Okay, fine. Now we have actually solved the problem also. There is no difficulty. We'll move on to now. Today, what is the status? You know, actually, it is 4 o'clock. Still, it is not closed. So today also, we are going to get 2 hours. Hello.
Unlimited.
Today also unlimited, so we'll go ahead with the we'll continue with this now. But next time we'll not get unlimited, right? Okay.
No, sir. This next time not unlimited.
Okay, so next time, next Monday when we have lecture, I will try another software, that is Cisco WebEx. Okay, so I'll send that also. We'll try once, and we will compare the what to say, which is better one. Then we can continue with the this thing, because in Cisco the benefit is that they give 50 minutes of run time compared to this 40 minutes on Zoom app. So therefore I would like to try that also. Let's see what happens. Now moving on to the our main problem, that is design of gear, gearbox. We have started that. So in continuation of that, it's important to understand what is gear ratio at every stage, and also what is overall gear ratio, what is minimum number of teeth on the gear, that is starting point for design of gears, and what should be the face width of the gear tooth. Okay, so we will discuss about these things here on this slide. So now in case of multi-stage gearbox, as I mentioned, at every stage there will be a gear ratio or velocity ratio, and we have discussed while discussing about guidelines of mechanical drives as well as gear drives, that at every stage gear ratio or that velocity ratio should not be more than 6, otherwise the overall arrangement will become bulky and the cost will shoot up. Okay, so that is the restriction over here. Now if you have two if you know that is I prime, it is total transmission ratio or total velocity ratio, then if you are assuming that two stages are sufficient, then you can just consider I, that is individual stage velocity ratio, is equal to square root of I prime, and if this is less than 6, that's fine. Otherwise we will go for next stage, that is three stage gearbox, so in which we'll consider I prime cube root of I prime. Okay, and essentially it will come down to less than 6, so that will, that in most of the applications it will satisfy the requirement. Okay, so that is very first part at the start of design of gearbox or design of gears here. Okay, now we'll discuss about minimum number of teeth in case of you have studied when you studied about gears in SEM 4, the minimum number of teeth on pinion to avoid interference is given.
Yes, sir.
Z minimum is equal to 2 upon sin square alpha, right? And for the pressure angle, there are three different systems are shown here, 14.5 degree, 20 degree and 25 degree. Minimum theoretical number of teeth. And now obviously we will be looking at 20 degree invalid profile, because it is mentioned by Bureau of Indian Standards. So theoretical value is 17 minimum for minimum number of teeth, but practically we can go till 14. Okay, so as a starting point for 20 degree full depth invalid tooth system, we need to assume the number of teeth on the pinion as 18 or 20. So we start with assuming 18, and if it is not satisfying the requirements, we move on to 20 like this. Okay, so in most cases we'll start with Z1, that is number of teeth on pinion as, or minimum number of teeth on the gear which we are designing will be 18. Then once you know minimum number of teeth on one gear, okay, so that may be driving gear or the gear for which you are designing, by using velocity ratio you can find out what is the number of teeth on gear which is in mesh, that is I is equal to ZG upon ZP, where ZG is the number of teeth on gear and ZP represent number of teeth on the pinion. Excuse me. Now there is very important term called hunting tooth in relation to teeth in contact. Okay, so when you find out the number of teeth on meshing gear, like for example, say teeth on, number of teeth on pinion is 20, and gear you find out by using the gear ratio the number of teeth on this gear are 40. Okay, so 20 on pinion, 40 on the gear. Okay, so in that case what happens, because the number is multiple of number of teeth on the pinion, every two cycles, every what to say, after every two revolutions of pinion, same pair of teeth will come in contact. Okay, and that will actually lead to what to say, you can say frequent contact between the same pair of the tooth, and there is the chance of wearing out of that particular tooth profile. Okay, so just to avoid this, what we do, instead of having 40 as the number of teeth on the gear, we either increase or decrease one tooth or one number of one tooth on that particular gear. So instead of considering 40, it will ZG will consider as 41 or 39. If you consider 41 for example, then what will happen, the same pair of the teeth will come in contact after 41 revolutions of pinion. Okay, so that is something called as hunting tooth. Okay, so we increase or decrease one tooth when there is even number of teeth on gear also. Okay, just to avoid even distribution of the forces and reduce wear. Okay, now this is about the minimum number of teeth, and at the same time we'll discuss about the what should be the face weight. Now as mentioned here in the design of gears, it is required to express the face weight in terms of module. Okay, so now there is no standard guideline for there are guidelines. What I'm saying is that there is no way how do we find out what is the face weight or what should be the face weight initially. Now if the face weight is too large, then there is a possibility of what is saying concentration of the forces at one end of the tooth because of say misalignment or elastic deformation of shafts of the gears or warping of the gear tooth itself because of very high friction and the heat produced because of that friction. Okay, so there may be warping of the tooth. So because of all these reasons, when you have a large face width, there is a chance that load will be concentrated on one end of the tooth. Okay, whereas if you consider very small face width, then it is not suitable for resisting the shock because at the time of contact there is a impact. Okay, so if the face width is very small, then it will not be in a position to resist that shock and absorb the vibration. Okay, also its capacity is reduced, and it is prone to wear, faster wear. Therefore, in practice, the optimum range of the face width is considered in terms of module between 8 times module into to 12 times module. But in preliminary stages of design, generally we consider B, that is face width of the tooth, as 10 times the module. So B is equal to 10 times module M. Okay, so I hope there is no difficulty in this. Okay, so now you write down, I ask you to write down this. Here, step 2 in your our main problem. So gear ratio, we will find on this slide what is the gear ratio, number of teeth and face width. So in the given problem, overall gear ratio is 10:1. That's what is mentioned in the statement of problem. Okay, so to decide I1 and I2, first of all we will consider I1 is equal to I2. Okay, and we will it is mentioned that it is two stage gearbox. Therefore, we will consider square root of overall gear ratio, that is under root 10. So it comes out to be 3.16. Okay, but then if you assume the gear ratios equal for both the stages, then there is a slight increase in the overall size of the gearbox. To avoid that, what we do, we will consider variable gear ratios. So we will slightly reduce this particular value of I1 and I2 from 3.16 to say this is a random value now. Okay, it's up to you, and obviously you'll have to make use of your past experience in this. So I1, let us assume I1 is 3.9. Okay, and then we calculate what is I2. So I2 is equal to 10, that is overall gear ratio, divided by this assumed I1 as 3.9. So that is equal to 2.56. Okay, so we have found out what are the velocity ratios for individual stage. Well, so I want you to write down these things because this is solution part in the problem which we are solving. Okay, so assuming 20 degree full depth involute tooth system, you need to write like this: the number of teeth on pinion Z1 is equal to 18. Okay, so write down this: the number of teeth on gear is calculated by velocity ratio I is equal to Zz upon Zp. So once you consider Z1 as 18, we will consider Z2. Why I'm using 1 and 2? Because there are two stages. So, and here we are considering two gears, Z1 and Z2. Okay, so make use of this I1 equal to 3.9 and find out what is zz. So what is value of z z2 or zz? Anybody? That's very simple. You have to just multiply z1 by i1.
So 70.2.
70.
Yes, 70.2.
70 or 65. So it is 3.9, right? Star 18. 70.2, right? So now it is close to 70. So here we can assume either 70 or 71. Now, as I mentioned, if you consider 70, then there is a chance of frequent mating of same gear pair. So to avoid that particular chance, we need to consider the odd number here. So let's consider 71. So you can write down number of teeth on Z2 as 71. Even you can consider 69, there is no difficulty. Just for uniformity, we'll maintain that it is 71. Okay, so now Z2 value is 71. Now let's assume B is equal to 10 times M. We don't know what is module right now, because we will find out, we will derive first of all what is the equation of module and then we will find out. But just right now, just write down there, assume B is equal to 10 M. So this is the second step in your solution. Moving on to next step, next stage, that is beam strength on gear tooth. So here we will derive what is the strength of gear tooth when they are in mesh, or when it is transmitting power from driving member to driven member. Okay, so the basic equation what we are going to study now is, or it was presented by Wilfred Lewis in 1892. Okay, so in a particular there is some engineers club in Philadelphia. Okay, so there it was presented, and still after so many years, maybe 100 plus years, still we are using this equation as a basis for beam strength of the gear tooth. Well, in this particular analysis, we assume that the gear tooth, a particular gear tooth, as a cantilever beam. Okay, so we understand cantilever beam. Okay, it is supported here. Okay, and there are certain assumptions in this analysis now. So we'll just go through one by one. The effect of radial component FR, which induces compressive stresses, is neglected. So we are not considering effect of FR in this direction. The tangential component FT is uniformly distributed over the face width of the gear. So as shown here, FT is uniformly distributed, which is not the case actually. FT is like sort of point load. The effect of stress concentration is neglected. Because it is a point load, there will be a concentration of stress in the vicinity of that particular point of force or point of application of the force. But we are neglecting that effect. At any time, one pair of the teeth is in contact and it takes the complete load. Okay, so these are the assumptions in this particular analysis. Now, what we studied in the force analysis on in the previous discussion, we are continuing with that only here in this case. So here, if you see, this is a single tooth of the driven member. Okay, so if you recall the same figure what I had shown previously. Okay, so there is a meshing of pinion and gear. And in that case, we had assumed that the pinion rotates anti-clockwise, whereas the gear rotates in clockwise direction. And in that case, then we can write, or we can show here resolved forces, FT in right direction, FR in the downward direction, as shown here. Okay. Now, in order to show this particular point here, we assume that in this particular analysis, this tooth or this particular tooth profile is considered as a parabolic beam of uniform strength. Okay, so this is very important here. Now, what is the meaning of this? For this particular parabolic beam, the stress at any cross section is uniform or same. So So if you consider this particular dotted line here, you can see this dotted line, that is the parabolic beam. That is again another assumption. And if you take any section along this cross section anywhere like this, at that particular, at any section, if you find out what is the strength of that beam, you will find that the strength will be same throughout. Okay, so that is the meaning of uniform strength parabolic beam. Now this particular parabolic beam, or this parabola, becomes tangential to the root of the tooth. Okay, so at this particular section XX, because the parabola is tangent to the tooth profile, that is the weakest section. Okay, now we will find out what is the bending moment at the particular section XX due to the force, tangential force FT, acting at this particular point at height h from the section. Okay, so it's like strength of material, application of principles of strength of material. Now we are taking moment about section XX and finding what is the bending moment about this particular section. So FT into h. Okay, so bending moment about section XX is given as FT into h, whereas area moment of inertia for this particular cross section, that is if you consider section XX and its projected cross section will be a rectangular one here, T cross B, face width into what is the thickness of the tooth at root. Okay, so that is the rectangular cross section, and for a rectangular cross section, area moment of inertia is given as BD cube by 12. So in that, B is considered as the depth. So here the force, excuse me. Okay, so the direction of the force, tangential force, is along the dimension T. So here depth will be considered as the thickness of the tooth. So that instead of BD cube, it will be BT cube. BT cube by 12. That is the area moment of inertia. And the neutral axis is passing through this half of the T. So it is Y is equal to T by 2. Any difficulty till now?
No, sir.
Okay. So we'll move ahead. So as I mentioned there, we found out bending moment is equal to FT into H on the previous slide, right? And we know bending equation, that is MB, or M by I is equal to sigma by Y. You have studied this bending equation in strength of materials. So we are making use of that equation and finding what is the sigma B, that is bending stress, equal to MBY upon I. We know all these expressions, so we have just substituted here. FT into H is MB, Y is T by 2, I is 1 by 12 BT cube. And because I had written by hand and there was no, or is a lack of some time, therefore I had just tried to get the photos of that and just pasted here. So in that analysis, I had considered instead of FT, PT. Okay, so tangential force I had considered as PT instead of FT. So let's keep this in mind. And sigma B is because of tensile stress, sigma T. Therefore here I had considered it is sigma T. So please bear with me with one or two slides like this. Okay, so sigma T is equal to PTH upon 1 by 6 BT square. So it is just a simplified version of this equation here. FTH, which is there, T will cancel out with this. So T square, 2, and this 12 will give you 1 by 6. Okay, so FTH by 1 by 6 BT square. This is the sigma B, that is value of bending stress at section XX on the previous slide. Okay, now I mentioned there that tooth profile is considered as a parabolic beam of uniform strength, right? So so what is the meaning of that? So this is a parabola, and let us consider sections 1, 1, 2, 2 along the, what is the height of that particular tooth, and let section 1, 1 is at height h1 from tip, section 2, 2 at height h2 from tip. In this way, at section 1, 1, we can write sigma 1, that is the bending stress, as from this equation, P PT H1 upon 1 by 6 BT square, T1 square. Okay, so because thickness is here T1 and at section 2 it will be T2. So like this we can write stress values or expressions at every section. So sigma 1, sigma 2 as PT H2 upon 1 by 6 BT2 BT B T2 square. And we know because it is a beam of uniform strength, all these well, sigmas, sigma 1 to sigma n will be equal to sigma t. Okay, so that is what is meaning of parabolic beam of uniform strength. Now again, for teeth cut with standard cutters, that is teeth having standard profile, we can write a relation between circular pitch and geometric dimensions of the tooth. So h and t are the geometric dimensions, okay, which define the what is the profile of the tooth. So h is proportional to circular pitch, and so we consider t is also proportional to circular pitch. And by assuming certain constants of proportionality, we can write h is equal to k1 into pc, t is equal to k2 into pc, and we know circular pitch is pi into m. Okay, so this equation one, that's what sigma t is equal to ft h upon 1 by 6 bt square, this is modified like this. Okay, so pt as it is, instead of h I have written k1 into pc here, substituted there. For t I have substituted k2 into pc. So and then simplifying this, we get pt, we cancel out this pc with one pc from this pc square, and I have taken this k1 downwards. Hello, any difficulty, any doubt? Well, so pt upon 1 by 6 k2 square upon k1, okay, into pc into b. Now this particular bracket represents a very important term or expression, that is 1 by 6 k2 square upon k1, called as Lewis form factor. Okay, and it is represented as small y. So small y, which is Lewis form factor, is equal to 1 by 6 k2 square upon k1. So if you substitute that in the previous equation for sigma t, excuse me, we can write expression for PT. So PT or FT, that is tangential force acting on that particular tooth, is equal to Y, that is this particular expression goes on this side, Y into PCB into sigma T. Okay, so let us consider this equation as equation A. Okay, so equation A gives the relationship between tangential force PT or FT and the corresponding stress sigma T or sigma B. And as this tangential force value increases, this stress sigma B or sigma T will also increase. Now when the stress reaches the permissible magnitude of bending stress, the corresponding value of PT or FT is called the beam strength. This is very important. Okay, so as you go on increasing value of tangential load, we will reach a limit wherein the value of stress in that particular beam will reach the permissible value of stress. Okay, beyond which you cannot go because a beam will fail after that, right? So the magnitude of force, tangential force, equivalent to what is the magnitude of permissible bending stress that beam can actually tolerate is called beam strength. Okay, so once again I repeat here, the beam strength Fs, now instead of Ft we are saying it is Fs because that is the maximum limit of Ft which is which can be sustained by that particular beam, which is and beam here is nothing but tooth profile, a single tooth. We have modeled that single tooth as a cantilever beam. Is the maximum value of the tangential force that the tooth can transmit without bending failure. Okay, so therefore it is called beam strength. Now replacing PT, that is FS, in equation A, the equation A is modified in this way. Okay, so now this equation is given in data book PSG 8.50. If you refer to that particular page, you will find FS is equal to in data book permissible stress or permissible or allowable stresses are written in square bracket. Okay, so this square bracket sigma b indicates permissible bending stress. Multiplied by b, that is face width, multiplied by y, that is Lewis form factor, into pc. Pc is circular pitch. Now, if you consider circular value of circular pitch as what is that? Pi d prime by z. Okay, and if you convert that particular pi d prime by z, okay, so we have defined diametral pitch as z by d prime. Therefore, we can write sigma b into b as it is from here. Okay, so instead of pc, it is m pi d prime here, and I have taken this d prime on the in the denominator, so that z upon d prime becomes pd, that is diametral pitch, and we have put this capital y instead of pi y. Okay, so capital y is equal to pi into y. So you just simplify this equation and we can write in different forms like this. So fs is equal to in terms of circular pitch, in terms of diametral pitch, or in common format which is generally written in the books is given here. So fs is equal to mb permissible stress sigma b into capital y. Now capital y is also considered as a Lewis form factor, which is just multiplied by a constant pi. Okay, so as such y and y are not non-different. In the value, this value of capital Y will be slightly more, or pi times more than Y. It's the same Lewis form factor. Okay. Okay. So now, if you look at that equation, Fs is equal to mb sigma b into y, the module and the face width are same for pinion as well as the gear, which are in mesh. When different materials are used, the product sigma b into y decides which one is weaker between pinion and gear. Okay, so if you go back to the slide here, if you look at this equation, m and b for both gear and pinion will be same. Okay, so this product sigma b into y will decide which one of the pinion and the gear is weaker. Okay. Now this Lewis form factor capital Y or small y is always less for a pinion compared to the gear, and therefore for same material for pinion as well as gear, pinion will be always weaker than the gear. Okay, so if you are using same material for gear as well as pinion, it is understood that pinion is weaker because a Lewis form factor Y is less. But if it is materials are different, we will have to decide on the basis of this equation sigma b into y. Okay, now from where to get these y values? Take y from table 40 on PSG, page number 8.53. So just for what is the sake of simplicity or convenience, I have shown that particular table here. This is from page number 8.53 in PSG data book. Okay, so it shows the number of teeth in one first column, and then remaining column shows different standard systems of tooth profile. So we will consider 20 degree full depth. FD indicates full depth. So 20 degree full depth involute profile, and we have found out 18, or we have assumed that 18 is the number of minimum number of teeth on the pinion. So capital Y will be 0.308. Here you can see, and we have found out number of teeth on gear as 71, right? So it is 70, close to 71. So we will consider this as the value of capital Y, that is 0.429. Now we'll move on to what is meaning of permissible bending stress. We have sufficiently discussed about what is Lewis form factor, which is one of the important terms in the analysis of beam strength of gear tooth. Okay, so now after that, another thing, important thing is sigma b, that is maximum or permissible bending stress. Okay, so we'll discuss about that and we'll move on to find out what is the module. So in order to understand this, what is the permissible bending, what should be the permissible bending stress, let us consider what are the forces acting on the tooth when they are in mesh. Okay, so this in this diagram it is shown. Let us consider this is the gear train, simple gear train. This is driving gear, idler gear, and driven gear. Or we can consider this figure here, driving, idler, and driven gear. Okay. So now, when this driving gear comes in, it is rotating in clockwise direction like this. So therefore, idler gear will rotate in anti-clockwise direction. So let us consider this particular portion or this particular contact. Okay. So the tooth on the pinion here will apply the force of in the downward direction because it rotates in clockwise like this. It will try to push the right hand this idler gear in this way. So therefore the idler gear will start rotating in anti-clockwise direction in this way. Okay. So if you look at this particular contact between the teeth, then what will happen? There is a when they are in first time they are coming in contact, there will be impact. Okay, so there will be like sort of impact and then it will push in this. So therefore, at that point, we see there is a immediate increase in the stress or corresponding force. Okay, it was initially zero because this particular portion of both the teeth, if you consider, suppose if this teeth had been here, it's not in contact with any other teeth. Whereas this particular teeth, if it had been here, still it is not in contact with any other teeth. So therefore there is no force, so or no stress. Okay, so it's zero. This particular diagram shows stress versus time diagram for driving and driven gears. Okay, so but when that contact happens, then there is a sudden surge. Okay, so it's like a sudden application of the load, its impact, and then as soon as it leaves the contact, again there is no load. So it will be sudden surge and then zero. Then again when it will come back, rotate this particular tooth will complete the revolution. Hello. So I hope that all of you are able to listen to me properly, careful, without any disturbance. Okay. So when this tooth will complete one complete rotation, it will come back to same position again, and then it will be repetition of the same phenomenon here. So you see this particular the same thing happens with driven gear also here. Okay, when you consider idler and driven gear, now idler gear becomes the driver and the driven gear becomes it is driven gear, right? So similar phenomena happens between these two gears also. So for driving and driven gears, we see there is a repeated force or repeated stress coming onto the teeth when they come in contact, right? But when you consider the idler gear, or before we go for explanation of that, I will just complete this particular repeated stress concept. Okay, so because it is repeated after every revolution, it is called repeated stress. Okay, and how do you find out what is the you might have studied in design one, design against fluctuating loads, right? In that case, you might have studied that in case of fluctuating or stresses, there are different types of fluctuating stresses: repeated, completely reverse. Okay, so in case of repeated load, we find out the magnitude of mean stress by considering what is the minimum and maximum value and average of that. So sigma max is maximum value and zero is the minimum value. So therefore, sigma max by 2 is the mean stress. Whereas amplitude is considered as sigma max minus sigma minimum, okay, divided by 2. So sigma minimum 0 here, so sigma max by 2. So in case of repeated stress, we see that mean stress as well as the amplitude of the stress is same. Whereas in case of completely reversing stress, which is the case when we consider the teeth on idler gear. Now in this case, if you look at the teeth, suppose this particular teeth, I was telling about this teeth, tooth, which is in contact with this tooth on the driving member. So when it is in contact, there is a surge in force. Now this same tooth, after after half rotation, it will come in contact with the tooth on the driven gear. But in another surface which is opposite. Here it comes in contact with, on the say top surface. This surface remains on the bottom side when it comes here. Okay, so there is a reversal of the force applied, because initially it was applied on this side, now it is applied in this side. Okay, so therefore you can see there is a surge at this particular point of contact, then for half revolution there is surge on the other side of the tooth surface. So you can see here it is completely reversing. What is meaning of completely reversing? It is changing direction. Okay, so initially on this side, if you show the tangential force, it is downward. It is downward, but in this case the tangential force will be it will be also downwards, but on the other surface. Okay, so when it was on this side, this tooth was bent, if it is allowed to bend, in this direction, whereas here it will bend in other direction, right? So it is completely opposite stresses are applied to the same tooth. Therefore this idler gear is subjected to completely reversing stress, and you see this stress time diagram as shown here. Okay, so and this is the case for one revolution. In the next revolution again it repeats the same way, right? So this is the case for idler gear. It is subjected to completely reversing stress. And in case of completely reversing stress, how do we find out what is the mean stress and stress amplitude? Okay, so in this case mean stress will be zero, because sigma max is positive, sigma minimum is negative of sigma max, so they cancel out each other, and half of that will be amplitude, that is sigma max minus is that minus minus becomes plus, so therefore sigma max twice divided by 2, therefore amplitude of completely reversing stress is sigma max. Okay, now because as we saw in this analysis, teeth are subjected to fluctuating stresses, and we cannot make use of then yield strength or just ultimate strength as the criteria of failure. Okay, so you might have studied in that design of fluctuating stresses, endurance limit is considered as the criteria for failure. So therefore in case of gears also, here we consider the maximum bending stress is equal to the endurance limit stress of the gear tooth. This is very important. Okay, so now endurance stress limit or endurance limit, I want all of you to just recall what is meaning of endurance limit stress. Okay, so or what is endurance limit? Okay, so just for repetition I will try to explain that. When a mechanical component is subjected to fluctuating stresses, hello, somebody saying something, any questions? No questions. Okay, fine. Well, I was telling when a mechanical component is subjected to fluctuating stresses, it is observed that particular component will fail, if it is going to fail, at a much much lower value than the yield stress or ultimate stress of that material, and that happens because of fatigue due to fluctuating stress. Okay, so that reduction in the strength of the material due to fatigue induced by the fluctuating stress is reduction in the resistance value of the material due to fluctuating stresses is called fatigue, and the material will fail due to fatigue. And fatigue failure, we will consider criterion of fatigue failure on the basis of endurance limit. Now what is meaning of endurance limit? Endurance limit is defined as the maximum value of completely reversing stress that a mechanical component can sustain for unlimited number of cycles without fatigue failure. Okay, so that is what is definition of endurance limit. Now this endurance limit stress of gear tooth depends on so many factors like surface finish of the gear tooth, size of the gear tooth, reliability used in the design. So you can reliability means say 96%, 90% of the components will satisfy certain requirements. Okay, so you have to just I want all of you to just refer basics of design against fluctuating load. Okay, so in that you will find similar reasons for endurance limit. Okay, stress concentration in gear tooth. Gears rotating in one direction or both direction. Gear tooth subjected to stress in one direction or both direction. So all of these factors will contribute to endurance limit stress of the gear tooth. Any difficulty till now? Well, we'll move on to next slide. Okay, so now because we are talking about failure of the gear tooth, it is important for us to know what are the different types of failure for gear tooth. Okay, so basic modes of gear tooth failure are breakage of the tooth due to static and dynamic loads, and second one is surface destruction. Now, in case of beam strength, we have considered that particular tooth will break because of bending stress, right? So in that case, if the complete breakage of the tooth can be avoided by adjusting the parameters in the gear design, such as module and face width, so that the beam strength of the gear tooth is more than the sum of static and dynamic loads. Now, we have not discussed about dynamic loads till now, but I had mentioned about dynamic loads. So in some or other, if you are able to take care of this, some of the static and dynamic loads is less than the beam strength, then we can avoid the breakage of the tooth due to static and dynamic loads. Okay, so we can take care of that in analysis itself. Now, if you look at surface destructions, there may be different causes of surface destruction, like abrasive wear, corrosive wear, initial pitting, destructive pitting, and scoring. Okay, so abrasive wear is because of fine particles in the lubricant. Now, when gears are used, and because of the contact at high speed and load, there will be friction developed between the contacting surfaces. Okay, so the resultant of that friction is heat. So to take away the heat as well as reduce the friction between surfaces, lubrication is very important in that case. Excuse me. Okay, so when we make use of lubricating oil or lubricant, it is there are chances that some fine particles, because it is some fine particles may be present in that lubricant while filling and taking out the lubricant from the gearbox, or during that operation of the gearbox, there may be very fine particles of the gear tooth. They might have been worn out. Okay, and they are lying in that particular lubricant. And when running at high speed, these fine particles become as a tool, and they will actually scratch the surface of the tooth. Okay, so that is abrasive wear. Now, abrasive wear is shown in this figure here. This is you can see the abrasions on the gear tooth profile here, made by super fine particles. Now, second one is corrosive wear. So corrosion may happen because of, again, lubricant or lack of lubricant or exposure of the gear tooth profile to the atmosphere. Okay, but typically it happens due to high pressure additives in the lubricant. They are generally corrosive. Okay, so corrosion happens, and it will start actually in something called as initial pitting. Okay, so initial pitting is about a bit by bit removal of the material due to corrosion here. Again, gear tooth wear is gear tooth wear is due to initial pitting. Now, as I mentioned, initial pitting may be because of corrosive wear, or it may start because of some impact at a localized portion frequently. So you can see there are small pits here. 1, 2, 3. Okay, so that is like a small amount of material is taken away from there, and that material surface is damaged. Okay, so that is initial pitting. Next is destructive pitting, which is actually leads to failure of gear tooth, which is shown in this figure here. Now, it will start as initial pitting, like small pits like this, and it will propagate along the surface, and so much so that the substantial amount of material is worn out because of that pitting. And that is called destructive pitting. And in this case, surface endurance stress becomes a design criteria, because and therefore you might have seen most of the gears, they are heat treated. Okay, so that means the tooth profile or tooth surface is hardened by using heat treatment, whereas the blank or the hub of that gear is softer. Okay, so this surface tooth surface is hardened to take care of the surface endurance limit. Now last gear tooth wear is scoring. The scoring happens because of the lack of lubrication. Okay, sometimes it happens so that there is a loss of oil film between contacting surfaces, and when there is a loss of oil film between contacting surfaces due to friction, there is a possibility of overheating of the teeth which are in contact, and because of that overheating, here what happens is the stick and slip phenomena. Like because of overheating, it's like welding and slipping, or welding and shearing, you can say. The phenomena is where the teeth tooth surface is welded and then sheared off, welded and sheared off whenever they come in contact. This particular stick and slip phenomena is known as scoring, and if it keeps on happening, it will actually damage the surface of the tooth profile. Okay, so these are the surface destruction, now these are the types of surface destruction, and it is one of the major cause of tooth failure. I hope there is no difficulty till now. Now as we are talking about the bending stress limit, permissible bending stress value for the material, now it becomes pertinent for us to understand how do we select materials for the gears. Okay, so selection of material depends on some desirable properties of the gear material. I am just taking you through this slide now. Okay, so point number one says that load carrying capacity of the gear tooth depends upon the ultimate tensile strength or the yield strength of the material. When gear tooth is subjected to fluctuating forces, the endurance strength of the tooth is deciding factor. So that's what we have discussed. The gear material should have sufficient strength to resist failure due to breakage of the tooth. Okay, so load carrying capacity is very important, and as I mentioned on the previous slides, the tooth is subjected to tangential load, static and dynamic. So it should be in a position to take care of static and dynamic load. Okay, so that is the first requirement of the gear material. Next one is, in many cases it is wear rating rather than strength rating which decides the dimensions of the gear tooth. So this is like second part. We are talking about now surface destruction. The resistance to wear depends upon alloying elements, grain size, percentage of carbon and surface hardness. The gear material should have sufficient surface endurance strength. That's what we discussed on the previous slide, to avoid failure due to destructive pitting. Okay, so this is a very important point. Sufficient surface endurance strength. Next point is, for high speed power transmission, the sliding velocities are very high and the material should have low coefficient of friction to avoid failure due to scoring. We discussed about scoring also. So sliding velocities are very high and material requirement is that it should have low coefficient of friction. Okay, so that's pretty clear, straightforward. And next point is, the amount of thermal distortion or warping during the heat treatment process is a major problem in gear applications, and due to warping the load gets concentrated at one corner. Now we discussed this about this particular point at the time of discussion about the face width also. Okay, so due to warping the load gets concentrated at one corner of the gear tooth. Well, alloy steels are superior to plain carbon steels in this respect, because they are not subjected to warping during the heat treatment due to consistent thermal distortion. Well, so these are the desirable properties of the gear material. So what are these? They should have sufficient strength against load carrying capacity in the form of static and tangential load. They should have sufficient surface endurance strength they should have low coefficient of friction, and they should not warp during heat treatment process, or they should have consistent thermal distortion. So these are the guidelines for selection of material. Now we'll discuss about what are the materials we are using for different applications. Okay, so gear materials, typically we make use of cast iron, steel, bronze, and phenolic resins. Now phenolic resins are used for non-metallic gears. So it's just mentioned here, we are not discussing about non-metallic gears. We will consider only metallic gears, and in that we will concentrate our attention on plain carbon steel or alloy steels. Now, large size gears, when you want to manufacture large size gears, obviously you have to cast the hub of that gear. So generally it is gray cast iron of different grades. It is cheap and less noisy compared to steel gears. Good wear resistance, because that is the typical property of cast iron, good wear resistance, but have poor strength. Now we have case hardened steel gears, which offer best combination of wear resisting hard surface together with a ductile and shock absorbing core. Okay, so generally, as I mentioned during previous slide, that gears are heat treated. Okay, so blank or the hub will be soft, whereas the tooth surface is hard, and that is done for this particular purpose. If there is a shock, the hub is in a position to absorb that particular shock at the core. Okay, so we just harden the tooth surface. Medium duty applications, we consider plain carbon steels such as 50 C8, 45 C8. We can have different types of plain carbon steels from data books. Heavy duty applications will obviously go for alloy steels, as mentioned here. Then for planetary gear trends, again we will go for alloy steels. Although steels are costly, they have higher load carrying capacity. Okay. In case of worm wheels, generally bronze is preferred due to its low coefficient of friction and excellent conformability. So also it is suitable where resistance to corrosion is important consideration in applications like water pumps. Okay, so but then their main drawback is excessive cost. Okay, so bronze is costly compared to other materials. Okay, so these are the guidelines, and these are the materials which we are going to select from the data book. Now, and we are discussing about the materials in relation to the permissible bending stress, because permissible bending stress depends on what material you are going to select. Okay, so I will just take you through the PhD data book pages, from where we are going to find out how to find out what is the permissible bending stress for the selected material. So that permissible bending stress depends on the material selected. Now, if you consider page number 8.18 from the PhD design data book, you will find there are two relations as far as the design bending stress is concerned. Okay, that is sigma b, permissible design stress. So rotation in one direction only, if that is the case, that means the one side of tooth will come in contact with the other tooth. So there is a force applied on the tooth surface in one direction only, or one side only. Whereas in case of rotation in both directions, or in case of idlers, you can see there is a force applied on the both sides of the tooth profile or tooth surface. So we consider these are the relations for sigma b permissible. Okay, so we modify this. So if you look at this equation here, 1.4 KBL upon N into K sigma into sigma minus 1. Okay, so KBL is life factor for bending. We can get it from table 22, which is on the page number, next page actually, 8.19. Or okay. Next is K sigma. It is fillet stress concentration factor. It is from table 21 we can find out. And sigma minus 1 is actually endurance limit stress in bending for complete reversal of the stresses. And this can be found from table 19. Now there is a relation between sigma O and sigma minus 1. Sigma O is, or sigma 0 is, endurance limit stress in bending for repeated stress. Okay, so we have discussed about repeated stress as well as completely reversal of the stresses. Okay, and then there is a relation between repeated stress and completely reversing stress as given here. Sigma O is equal to 1.4 into sigma minus 1. So we can find out sigma minus 1 from table 19, because in both relations we require sigma minus 1. And in this way, and last point is factor of safety small n. That is in given in table 20 for different applications and different materials. Okay, so we can find out all these quantities from data book, make use of these values here for given selected material, and find out what is the design bending stress. So again, I will just take you through these many pages just for having a feel of that. Okay, so because we are not actually immediately going to these pages, so this is the table for sigma minus one. Factor of safety, you can see all those things here. We will discuss when we are actually solving that using these things in the problem solution. Stress concentration factor, life factor for bending, that is KBL. So these are the tables which are taken from the data book, PSG design data book. Now I want you to write down this particular step. Well, but then it is around 7 minutes to or 10 minutes to 5. Okay. So we will stop after Lewis form factor. Okay, so I want you to write down this particular step in your notebook. Step number 3, Lewis form factor and selection of materials. Okay, so whatever we have discussed till now, this is in relation to beam strength, and we have found out that beam strength is equal to MB sigma B into Y. So M is module, B is face width. Okay, so that will be same for pinion as well as the gear. Okay. And how to find out module, we'll discuss after that. We have assumed that beam strength is a 10 times module. And for sigma B, we will consider some material, and on the basis of these materials, I have just explained how to find out sigma B, permissible value of bending stress. And then we want to find out what is the Lewis form factor for pinion and gear. Okay, so as I mentioned, Lewis form factor is it is a form factor, so it depends on the geometry of the gear tooth. Okay, and the geometry also dictates the number of teeth on that particular gear. Therefore, we can say form factor also depends on the number of teeth. Therefore, we will go for page number 8.53. If you are having this particular page data book with you, either soft copy or hard copy, you can say, just go to page number 8.53 and refer to table number 40. And tell me what is the, actually I told you about this in the one of the previous slides, right? So I'll just go back to that slide. And you write down these values in your notebook. Are you with me? Any response?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so yeah, so here I have shown table number 40 on the from the page number, what is that page number? 8.53. Yeah, yeah. So I want you to open that page. Why I want you to open that is just to have a habit of using it. Okay, so well, we have found out 18 number of teeth, or we have assumed the 18 number of teeth on the pinion. So write down this value of capital Y, which is Lewis form factor, as for pinion it is 0.308. So write down this value in your notebook. And we have considered or found out what are the number of teeth on gear. It is 71. Okay, so we'll consider what is the value for 70. It is 0.429. Okay, so have you written these values in your notebook?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so please do that, because I'm not going to check it physically. Anyways, I don't know whether we are going to start maybe coming to the college and all those things. But it's in your benefit that whenever I tell you to write down your notebook, you please write down. That will be helpful to you, because you will have a proper problem solution in your notebook. So there is no need for you to search upon these things afterwards. Okay, so as I mentioned, we will select material next time, because it will take some time. And after 5, do you have class today?
Yes, sir. Mostly.
Okay, okay. Then I think we'll stop here. It's
Yes,
five to 6 minutes to five. So I once again I request Swati to send me the attendance. But Swati, you did not send me the screenshots yesterday.
Okay. Yes, sir. I've taken the screenshots.
Today you send the screenshots also, because I found difficulty with that particular attendance in the chat. And many times people log in, log out. There are 100 and maybe more than 300 entries. Okay. So
yes, sir. That is why it's difficult to take the screenshot as well, because like at different times there are different participants in there.
No. Mm-hmm. Then what you do? You take at the start, maybe 5 to 10 minutes after the start. Okay, and towards the end, just two times.
Okay,
so those who are present during that time, that will be considered as the attendance. Okay, but then difficulty is that sometimes we may lose the connectivity and all those things. Just somebody is playing with the CPD. Okay, thank you for removing that. Well, we'll stop here. See you next week. Okay, and next week most likely we are going to have meetings on Cisco WebEx software rather than having Zoom meeting. Okay, so I'll send you the details for that through Swati and Junior sir. So see you then. Have a nice weekend. No, a nice week ahead. Okay, bye.